Welcome to this class. Today we would be understanding what are arguments, what is a premise, what is a conclusion, and most importantly, we would be finding method that would help us analyze whether a particular statement is a premise or a conclusion. Now, this is the most important segment where most of the students are struck up, because if there is a passage that is given, students are unable to understand whether the sentence is a premise or it's a conclusion. Now, we would be working out some very easy tricks that would help us find or locate a premise and a conclusion. So, before we begin with finding the method to analyze whether it is a premise or a conclusion, let's first start with the basic meaning of all the three words that we are talking about. So, premise. Whenever I say premise, I am providing an evidence to the conclusion. For example, if I say Shweta is not well, Shweta didn't go to school. Now here, if I go through these two sentences, what would be a premise or what would be a conclusion? So, premise is an evidence which is leading to a conclusion. So, my evidence is that Shweta is not doing well, and my conclusion here would be she didn't go to school. So, conclusion is always supported by a premise. So, this is a conclusion, this is a premise. So, premise provides an evidence for conclusion, while conclusion is supported by at least one or more premise. And then what is argument? So, whenever I am having one premise which is accompanied by a conclusion, at least minimum of one premise that is accompanied by a conclusion, then I can say this is an argument. So, to understand argument, it is very important that you have a premise and a conclusion. Now, this is the main area where most of the students are struck up, as they are unable to identify whether a passage has what would be the premise in the passage and what would be the conclusion in the passage. So, before we start to understand that, there are few things that we must be clear about. We would be understanding about two basic elements. One is propositional utterances and next is non-propositional. Let's understand what is propositional and non-propositional. So, propositional is a statement that provides you a straightforward behavior which shows whether it would be true or it would be false in nature. For example, this door is black, this board is white, these letters are yellow. So, this is an exact statement that is providing me either true information or false information. If I say this board is yellow, then I say that this is a false statement because I can visualize this board as white. So, it would be either true in nature or it would be false in nature. So, I have statements like door is black, Cherry is a cute baby, and Sheenu is Cherry's mother. So, this statement would either be correct or incorrect. That's the only option these kind of statements have. And these statements are usually direct statements. This is when we understand the word prepositional. Now, let's move on to non-prepositional. Non-prepositionals are never direct statements. They usually come in three forms. One is the form of question, the other is the form of command, and third is the form of expression of feelings. Now, if I ask you a question, who am I? I am not working about whether this statement is true or false. Okay? So, when you are not working around whether a statement is true or false, or you cannot say whether this statement would be true or false, it is non-prepositional in nature. So, any kind of question, where do you live? How is your class? So all these questions are non-propositional in nature. Next kind of non-propositional statements can be command or orders. Do it. Finish the homework now. So these are kind of orders or commands that you are providing, and these are again non-propositional in nature because you cannot say whether it is true in nature or false in nature. And last is expression or feelings. I'm very happy. Three cheers. Hip hip hooray. So anything which works as expressions or feelings would be non-prepositional in nature. So this is again the basic three elements that we talk about non-prepositional utterance. Now we are very clear whether a statement is prepositional, whether I can say this statement is correct, incorrect, or I do not have a kind of information that can lead me to whether this statement would be correct or incorrect. Now, if I move on to understanding the premise and conclusion, it becomes very interesting. So when we are identifying premise and conclusion, there are two things that we focus on. First is premise indicator and the next is conclusion indicator. So one would be premise indicator and the next that we would be talking subsequently is conclusion indicator. Let's first start with the first aspect, that is premise indicators. Premise indicators are those indicators that help you identify or locate a premise. So for example, if I have a whole lot of passage that is given and I have to identify the premise, how can I do that? I can do that by two means, either by means of premise indicator or conclusion indicator, because by means of conclusion indicator, I can identify the conclusion, and what would not be the conclusion in that case would become the premise. So with either means, I can find out both premise and conclusion. Now the interesting thing here is, let's read this statement. Sunita is not going to school since she is not well. So when I'm saying since she is not well, so she is not well is an evidence, and this evidence supports the conclusion, and the conclusion here becomes Sunita is not going to school. The same example that we tried to understand few minutes ago. So here you have identified the premise, and since you have identified the premise or the evidence, you can find out the conclusion. And what is the premise indicator here? The premise indicator is the word since. Now you have a list of indicators that help you identify premises. These lists include since, that we have already talked about, for, then you have because, given that, for the reason that, in view of the fact that. So let's discuss few examples. I'm not going to school today because it is raining. So it is raining is an evidence that is identifying or providing me a support for the conclusion that I'm not going to a school. So because becomes a premise indicator, and it is raining becomes a premise, and the remaining becomes a conclusion. I can come to your house given that you provide me sufficient information about your address. So if I have the information about your address, I can come to your house. So given that you provide me information about address becomes the premise, and that would help me reach your home. So reaching home would be a conclusion in this case. So this is how we work with premise indicators. Now let's just go back quickly and see the same statement that we have studied for premise indicator. So premise indicator, I say Sunita is not going to school since she is not well. Now if I want to convert the same statement into a conclusion indicator, how can I do that? Sunita is not well, therefore she will not go to school. Now this statement is just a rearrangement of what has been previously mentioned, but this rearrangement converts this statement from premise indicator to conclusion indicator. And let's see how. The word therefore helps you provide the conclusion that she is not going to the school, and this therefore, hence, so, henceforth becomes words or phrases which are indicating conclusion. So whenever you are solving any mathematical question, at the end you say hence, answer would be this, or therefore we reach to a conclusion, so and so. So that means this therefore, hence, therefore, so, these become indicator of conclusion. So here therefore indicates that she is not going to school, and this becomes a conclusion, and this as same remains the premise. But this word, in spite of this word which was a premise indicator, this word becomes a conclusion indicator. So let's go on to conclusion indicator. So here is the same statement what I have written there. Sunita is not well, so she is not going to the school. So rather than using the word therefore, I am using so as a conclusion indicator. Another example can be, Sunita studied a lot, therefore she secured good marks. So securing good marks is the conclusion here, and that conclusion comes through the evidence that she studied a lot, and the conclusion indicator here is therefore. So if you have any passage or any set of information that is given, based on that set of information you can quickly and easily identify what would be the premise and what would be the conclusion. So words like therefore, thus, hence, henceforth, so, accordingly, for this reason, consequently, and it follows that are indicators of conclusion. With help of these words, you can easily reach to a conclusion. So these are the two simple methods that you can apply to identify whether a given statement is a premise or the given statement is a conclusion. Now, whenever we are talking about an argument, as I said previously, we must have a premise and a conclusion. There can be references to premise from the conclusion which can be independent and which can be dependent. Let's see how. Now here I have the first statement, so I have marked it as 1, 2 and 3. 1 and 2 are the premise and 3 is the conclusion. So let's understand this in the fashion. This is a premise and this is a conclusion. My first premise states, cup is made of china clay. So it's giving me information about cup. That's a basic statement that I have. The next premise I have, china clay is a substance that is breakable. Now my conclusion says, cup is made up of breakable substance china clay. To understand this, let's try to hide out the first premise. If I hide out the first premise, I just have information china clay is breakable. So with this first statement missing, if I don't have the first statement, the only set of information that I can give is breakable substance china clay. Now let's say what happens if 2 is missing. If 2 is missing, the only information that I can do is cup is made up of china clay. I cannot say whether it is breakable or non-breakable. So to make this conclusion true, what is important here is I must have information which comes from premise 1. I must have information that comes from premise 2. And only when I have information that is coming from both premise 1 and 2 jointly, I can say the conclusion or 3 here would be true. So I can say this statement works only if and if both the premises are jointly taken into account, therefore we call such behavior as joint inference. So inference means reaching to a conclusion or concluding something, and I can reach to a conclusion only with the joint information that is provided by the two premises. So that is an example of joint inference. As I said, by hiding either one or two, I cannot reach to the conclusion three. Now let's work on a separate example. I have another example here. Again here, one and two are premise and three is a conclusion. Now let's understand what works here. So I have the first premise as pure gold is 24 carat. My second premise is most jewelry is made up of 22 carat pure gold. And my conclusion says carat explains purity of gold. Now, if I hide a statement 2, so what I am doing is I am hiding a statement 2. If I hide a statement 2, I can say pure gold is 24 carat, and if with this information I say carat is a unit that explains purity of gold, it is correct because I am saying the 100% pure would be 24 carat in nature. So with 2, I can if I remove premise 2, with premise 1, I can reach to a conclusion 3. Now let's remove premise 1. I just have premise 2 with me. So I'm removing this. I have most jewelry is made up of 22 carat pure gold. Now again the word pure is given here, and this says 22 carat. That means carat is again a unit that is measuring the purity of gold. So with this statement or with this premise, I can again say the conclusion can be correct. So what is happening in this case is, if I have just a single premise 1, I can say my conclusion would be correct. If I just have a single premise 2, I can again say my conclusion would be correct. This means both the premise are independently influencing the conclusion. So both the premise, when independently influence the conclusion, it is known as independent inference. Again, inference means conclusion or concluding. So I can independently reach to a conclusion with either premise 1 or premise 2. Even if both the premises are given, I can reach to premise 3. But I do not necessarily need both of the premises together to derive this conclusion. And these kind of statements or these kind of problems are known as independent inferences. So in exam, in any case, you have a set of statements that are given and you are asked to find out whether it is a joint premise or an independent premise or an independent inference. How can we do that? The best way is first identifying the premises and the conclusion in the given question. The second step would be hiding out premises. So when you try to hide out premises, what happens is you try to understand, if I have removed this, whether this premise would be sufficiently reaching to this conclusion or not, and so on. So this would be the methodology for us to find out whether a statement or a problem given is an example of joint inference or a independent inference. We would be understanding formal and informal fallacies in the next session. You can subscribe to ExamRace channel for any further updates. Till then, have a good day ahead.